God's able to give us handfuls of purpose in this life, isn't it? He sustains us. He lets us know that we're walking down the right path, that we're in the right field, aren't we? That we stay near to Him. And I'm thankful for His grace and His mercy, that He's able to help us. And thankful for the realness of the relationship that we have with God. It's not just a spoken word, but there's a closeness and a fellowship that we have with Jesus. We do have a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. We have someone that we can talk to. I was praying this morning and praying about this hour and this service and different things in life, and I was explaining to God that you know all about tomorrow, but I don't. But I'll trust you with that. And I want to trust Him with everything. I don't even know if tomorrow comes. This may be the last time I get to go to church. Well, we just don't know. We don't have a promise of that. But we do have this promise that He said He wouldn't leave us or forsake us. He's with us. And He'll walk with us through the valley of the shadow of death, so we don't have to fear any evil. His rod and His staff, they comfort us, don't they? He's right here with us. The Lord is our shepherd. Hey, that makes all the difference in the world, doesn't it? The Lord is our shepherd. Not just anybody. It's not your mom, your dad, or the deacons, or the preacher, or the pastor, or anybody else. But it's the Lord that is our shepherd. If the Lord is our shepherd, then these promises are to us, aren't they? They are. Have you noticed that when He wrote in the 14th chapter of John, and He was speaking to His disciples and to all those that would believe in Him and trust in Him, let not your heart be troubled. But it was pretty specific who He was talking to. If you don't have your trust in God, then yes, you should be afraid. Yes, you should tremble. Because you don't have the assurance in your heart that you got a better place to go to. I thought about it this way, and we'll read the scripture and trust the Lord. It's over in Lamentations, the 3rd chapter. And I won't be before you long today. I know we got some things the church wants to do today, and so we just want to trust the Lord with it, but But as we've been praying and trusting in God over the last several weeks, and you heard the message, I guess, about 3 weeks ago, and I still have this burden. I don't know how many people have passed away this week. And I don't know how many people died without knowing God. But we have right now. And we have this time. I was listening to a preacher that had such a desire for the church to be near to God and to understand that hell is real and to understand that people are dying every day and going to hell. But God has gave us a commission to go out into all the world and preach the gospel. Listen, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation, to the Jew first, but also to the Greek. It's what we need to preach. That's what this church needs to stand on. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. That Jesus came to save sinners. Praise God that He did. He didn't leave us alone. You don't have to be rich to be saved. You don't have to be popular to be saved. You don't have to be famous to be saved. You just got to come to Jesus just like you are. And if you will humble your heart, He will lift you up. The Bible teaches what a wonderful blessing it is that He teaches us. Listen, it is not His will that any should perish, but all come to repentance. I'm so thankful that He saved me. I'm so thankful that I can testify that I am a child of God by His mercy and His grace through His blood that He shed on the cross, and justified by His resurrection that He rose and He's alive and He lives forevermore, and He's my God, He's my Savior, and He's my Lord. And yes, I'll try to read here in just a minute, but I'm so blessed today. I'm saved, and I'm thankful for it. I'm thankful for it. I'll listen over in Jeremiah, and then this book was written by Jeremiah also, but you can read and say, Lord, if you heal me, I'll be healed. If you save me, I'll be saved. Oh, how gracious God is, and how good He is. We know, if you study the Bible and study a little bit about Jeremiah, the burden that he had. And they called him the weeping prophet. He had such a burden for Judah and for his people. They were in idolatry, and he lived through five kings or so, and only had one, Josiah, that revival come, and they would kill the prophets, and they would cast him into prison. He would be persecuted, and he was warning them that if you don't go, turn back to God, Babylon's going to come down, and you're going to be taken over. And all that happened, all it did. But he would get discouraged from time to time. And preachers and pastors get discouraged from time to time. And one of the discouraging things that can happen is when some seemingly people aren't listening to the Word of God and aren't taking heed to the Word of God. And you preach and you preach. I've noticed this through the churches that I've pastored in my life. You kind of see an up and down. And at first, people are curious or whatever it is, and they come in and they seem to listen for a little while, and the church moves, and there's blessings there, and different things goes on. But after a while, they just kind of get right back out to where they were at. And it can be discouraging, isn't it? It is. In this chapter here, you can see an up and down in Jeremiah's emotions and heart. And I'm thankful that we can tell God our heart. I'm glad when I'm upset, I get to tell God I'm upset. I'm glad when I'm afraid, I can tell God, hey, I'm afraid. I'm glad that when I'm not feeling well, that I can tell God, listen, I just don't feel good right now. I'm glad that I can go to Him and say, God, I don't understand everything that's going on in this world, but I'm going to trust You with it. And I love You. And he talks about this, and we're going to start reading in the 21st verse of the third chapter of Lamentations. But even goes, before you get there, in the 18th verse and on up above that, and he says, and I said, my strength and my hope are perished from the Lord. And remembering mine affliction and my misery and the wormwood and the gall, my soul hath them still in remembrance and is humbled in me. Now listen to this verse, and this isn't just like the Holy Spirit. This I recall to my mind. Therefore, I have hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because His compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore, while I hope in Him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for Him, the soul that seeketh Him. It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. And I'm going to stop reading right there, and you can read the rest of this. But the homework kind of goes along with this, and I'm going to read just a verse out of it. But the homework is the 103rd, and I've gave it to you before. But it's the 103rd chapter of Psalm. It says, the Lord, in the 8th verse, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Like a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. For he knoweth our frame, and he remembereth that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass, as a flower of the field, so he flourisheth. For the wind, for the wind passeth over it, and it is gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, and his righteousness unto his children's children, to such as keep his covenant, and to those that remember his commandments to do them. I'm going to stop reading right there. But we're going to pray just for a second, just for a minute. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that you've not dealt with us according to our iniquities, according to our sin. But you've had mercy. And I find so much comfort in your word that tells me that it's new every morning. That you've had compassion towards us because you know we're but dust. You know that we tend to fall and stumble. But some way, somehow, you've put this desire in our heart to be close to you and to know we need your mercy and we need your grace. Bless this church. Encourage them. I know that you love them. I know that you died on the cross to pay for all of our sins. And Lord, I know what you put in my heart. And I'm so thankful, dear God, that you put something in my heart that burns in my bones, that I can't be quiet, but I have to proclaim your goodness and your mercy. Oh, Lord, how gracious you have been to me and how good you are today. If there's someone lost, Lord, please save them. Give us understanding of your word. Help us, Lord, to know you. Put it in our heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. As always, this altar is always open. And if you have a need, you don't have to wait till I get done. But come to Jesus. Come to him. He knows our hearts and he knows our minds. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. Praise God for that, isn't it? We know our own mind, don't we? We know our heart. We know you can read over in Jeremiah, another place in Jeremiah where it talks about the heart is deceitful and is wicked, isn't it? We know that. This carnal nature, we see it in evidence today in this land, in this country that we live in, and throughout the world, that people are against God. They're against him. Listen, I want to tell you, the chaos that you see isn't just a happenstance. Isn't just somebody that now dreamed it up. The people are against God and against his ways. That's what's going on. They despise this word. They despise the absolute morality that God has put in Christians' hearts, and they want to stamp it out. That's where we all tend to go, don't we? Listen, I want to tell you this. There's a lot of people, they want to go their own way. They tend to get caught up in the flesh. And even church people and church members, when they start tending to do that, they don't want to be around other church people. They don't even want to go to church anymore. They don't want to be judged, do they? But you know what happens? There's some truth to that. Judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it's going to begin here, the word has to be preached, doesn't it? The word has to be preached just like God wants it preached. Through the power of God and the Holy Spirit, that conviction will set in. Listen, conviction is a good thing in our hearts. It draws us near to a merciful God. This that I recall, he says, and he goes to say, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. He's a consuming fire, isn't he? It's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living God. But he loves you, church. He died for you. You're his bride. You're his beloved. He cares about you. I think about Jesus when he looked out at Jerusalem and he said, "Oh, Jerusalem," and he cried, "Jerusalem, how oft I would gather you as a hen would gather her brood under her wings, but ye would not. You have killed the prophets." People have rejected God, but church, we don't reject God, do we? We don't. We accept him. We accept his word that it is true and absolute. Let God be true and every man a liar. It's true. And he tells us it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. Because why? His compassions fail not. I'll testify this. Do you ever get fed up? Have you ever got fed up with people? I remember when my children were small, and I don't know if I ever said it out loud, but I sure did think of it, and I think, I'm just about fed up with this. I probably said it. Jared could probably tell on me. I'm about fed up with it, Jared. But Jared was a really good kid, so. And I'm thankful for my children. And then sometimes on our jobs, we can say, I'm about fed up with it. And we sometimes lose that empathy we have one for another, don't we? And that understanding that we need to have for one another. Now, I know there's lines drawn, and I know God's got a line drawn out there too. And I know there's a day that time will be no more. I understand that. And I know the Bible says after death, judgment comes. I understand all that. And I'm glad I've got a father that knows me. And the word tells me his compassions fail not. Then even when I have messed up, even when I have chosen the wrong path, his mercy is new this morning. You get that? You feel that in your heart that this morning's a new day. It's a new day. And his compassions fail not. Listen how gracious God is. Oh, listen, that every day he helps us. Every day he is near us. He said, "Draw nigh to me," praise God, "and I will draw nigh to you." So if we're away from God, whose choice was that? Whose choice is that? If you don't come to God and he's tugging at your heart and his mercies are new this morning, whose choice is it that you have not drawn nigh to God? It's yours, isn't it? Oh, listen. It's of the Lord's mercies that we're not consumed because his compassions, they fail not. It says they are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Oh, listen, I'll go back to this comparison or this analogy with fruit then. And how often do we get fed up? And then we don't even want to talk to anybody anymore. Right? He could be our brother, our sister. Well, listen, they said something, it hurt my feelings. I don't even want to be around them anymore. I don't even want to talk about them. I don't want to hear anything about them. And we get this bitterness that's in our hearts and our lives when we do that. But listen to what God says. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Listen, he's true to us. He loves us. Every day. Every eternity. Oh, what a blessing it is to be part of his church. His bride. Isn't it? There's blessings. There's blessings. It says here, the Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore will I hope in him. We didn't preach a message last week about hope, didn't we? But my hope is in him, isn't it? Listen, where are they that have no confidence in the flesh, the Bible says. That's my flesh or anybody else's. We tend to fail. We tend to come short. We tend to make mistakes. But God is faithful and true, and he never makes a mistake. And he loves us, and he knows your down sittings and your uprisings. Oh, as the psalmist said, if you make your bed in hell, thou art there, oh God. He loves you. He formed you. He ordained you before the foundation of the world. What a blessing that is. He knows you, church. He's called you. He's chosen you. Great is his faithfulness. Great is his faithfulness. I'm going to ask you something personal in your heart. You that know Jesus, you that have asked him in your heart, you that have the Holy Spirit of God in your life, have you found these words to be true? Have you experienced them in your life? Have you ever been to the point where you have known that you've failed God and you've went to him with a broken heart and you thought, there's no way, there's no way, he won't even listen to me. And the devil's told you these lies and he's trying to keep you from God. But when you got there, you found mercy and you found compassion and you found that they failed not. And he found that he is faithful. Oh, listen, I just the way I was brought up, I guess, and the way I've grown up about myself. And I sometimes can get down on myself. I know that. And there's times that I need to be repentant and I need to get things straight. But I want to tell you this. My Bible teaches me God loves me. And that we're more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. That we're beloved, we're called, that we're chosen, and we're a child of God. And we get to go to the throne of God and cry, Abba, Father. And the Bible teaches us in the 8th chapter, we don't even know how to pray as we ought. But he is able to make intercession for us. That's what kind of God we've got. That's what kind of God. When you are so burdened. So burdened that you don't even know how to pray. But you get on your knees before a holy and righteous God. And you just weep. You just weep. And some way, somehow, God shows you that compassion. And shows you that his mercy is new every morning. Every morning. Great is thy thankfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. How gracious God is and how good he is. I'm going to trust the Lord with this day and every day. And God knows why he put this on my heart today. And God knows what it means in my heart. But my trust is in him. Where's your trust at today? Where is it? Oh, we mentioned it last week. What's your hope in? Where's your faith at? it's in things of this world, it's going to fail. It's going to fail. We've lived long enough to know that, haven't we? But is it in the Lord? Is it in the Lord? Jared, do you mind playing just real quick? We're going to pray. We're going to have an altar call today. And as he comes, I want to read a scripture in Hebrews. If I can find it real quick. In the second chapter. The first verse says, you can go ahead and play, Jerry. The first verse says this: therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For the word spoken by the angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders and divers miracles and the gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. If we got what we deserved, how are we going to escape if we neglect so great salvation? We won't. The world won't. So the burden's real in my heart. When this world rejects Jesus, doesn't accept that he is the Son of God, not just a good man, not just a prophet, the religion's wrong. They need the truth. He is the Son of God. He is the hope, the only hope that we have to be saved. The only hope. And this world will not escape when they reject Jesus. Oh, don't reject him today. I'm going to pray. The altar's open. If you feel a need, come this way. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word, for your power, for your mercy, for your compassions, for reminding us that they're new every morning. Your mercies are from everlasting to everlasting, and they're available to us if we'll just trust in you, Jesus. We pray for this church. We pray that you'd bless them, bring them in one accord. Lord, I know you want to bless them. And I know you have. You've been with us today. I know you're with us right now. And we want to lift you up. Oh, God, you have blessed. You're our Lord. And we find comfort in you. I pray, Lord, that you'd be with those that may be lost that's heard this message today. Lord, that you would touch them. Lord, that you would convict our hearts, that they would come to you, dear Jesus, Lord, before it's too late. Lord, you have warned us about hell, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth, where the fire is not quenched and the worm dieth not. Lord, you've shown us this awful, awful place. But you showed us that you will save us. And now is the time. Today is the day of salvation. Bless and encourage, Lord, we pray. Bless this church. We love them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.